cricket days, how it all started for you.
Hello everyone. Thank you Vishal for this opportunity to share my story first of all.
Pleasure, ma'am.
Actually, to be very honest, I started my cricket very late as compared to the kids now, definitely. Because I started up as a profession, I started after 10th standard. But I used to definitely play in my building and my society.
Okay.
So it was like, initially I started playing badminton from 3rd standard.
Okay.
So from 3rd standard to 9th standard, it was badminton. But I had a jaundice in 9th standard, so I had to stop the coaching, training and all sort of because of the jaundice happened. And then later on, it was like, then I had my 10th standard and then it just stopped. But definitely, I continued playing later on as well, just for fun actually. But cricket started pretty late actually. After the 10th standard exams were over, I was searching everywhere for a coaching camp as such. But initially, I couldn't find any sort of coaching camp. I went to the PYC, but that time girls were not allowed there. Deccan, there was no coaching there. So one day I just saw an ad in the newspaper regarding a coaching camp at Nehru Stadium, Pune. So I was very happy to see that ad first of all. And I've heard many stories like parents, few people have to take permission from parents. Here it was just the opposite actually. My parents were all in for my cricket or any of the sport which I took. But we were not finding a coaching camp, so it was. They were also happy that I could finally join a coaching camp, and it all started from Nehru Stadium actually.
So, were your parents also interested in cricket?
They do. I mean, my dad watches a lot of cricket. Even my mom has, in her college days, has gone and watched few matches. International matches in Mumbai. She's from Mumbai, so she used to go into the stadiums and watch the match. So, like everyone in the family definitely loves cricket, but no one has played cricket as a profession or even for a club level.
So, after the board exams, after your 10th got over, in the summer vacations, you were searching for a cricket club.
Yeah.
Okay, and you landed at PYC.
I was inquiring everywhere. So, I went to PYC at Deccan, but after that, I was like, I read this news about coaching camp at Nehru Stadium. And it was only for girls. So I was very happy to join that. Yeah. So that was the first, unfortunately. But nowadays there are pretty many coaching camps in Pune happening in the summer vacation.
So you got enrolled in this cricket academy following the newspaper ad which you saw. What happened next? How many months did you practice at this academy? Who were your initial coaches who got introduced you to professional cricket?
Initially, we had two senior cricketers from Maharashtra, like Amrita Shinde and Kalyani Dokrikar, who at that time. Then there was Suresh Dumke sir, who used to come there daily, who used to be the coach for the camp and all. But after this camp, we used to play matches with boys. So fortunately, I got chance to play in those matches as well, and then I was selected for the under-19 Maharashtra team immediately after the camp. Because I think that was because of the fielding which I used to do, because I used to love doing fielding.
Okay.
So maybe that's the reason I was in the team, I guess.
Okay. So it all started because of fielding.
Yeah, and there was no fear for the cricket ball.
Okay. And soon after you got a place in the under-19 Maharashtra team.
I think I was first into the senior national team and then I was into under-19 team because there was first senior tournament. So I was into that in 97 and then I played the under-19.
So the senior tournament that you're talking about, was it in Bihar?
Actually, I'm a bit confused. One was in Muzaffarnagar and one in Pune.
Okay.
In between, there were under-19 tournaments at Hazaribagh. And Hazaribagh, I mean.
Okay. Initially, you got selected for the senior nationals and then after that, you made your cut into the under-19 team. Any memorable matches, any specific knocks that you remember or probably your first match of the under-19?
Yeah, actually, more than the knock or the first time when I was selected for the under-19, we had the tournament at Guwahati.
Okay.
It was my first tournament in my life, and I had to travel unreserved for 3 days, which I had never done in my life. That itself was an experience, and I was like, oh, we don't have a reservation. Because at that point of time, we used to be like, there were few reserved seats, and then rest of us had to share that.
Yeah.
So it was, of course, that was fun, but it was being for the first time traveling like that.
Right.
It got a bit like, oh, I have to travel unreserved for 3 days, and that was a bit difficult. We were playing West Bengal, so it was Julen and Trumeli who had already taken 3 to 4 wickets for, and then we had a 100+ run partnership. We almost won the match. We lost it by 2 runs.
Yeah, right.
So that was actually a good and a bad memory, you can say.
But I'm sure there was a lot of learning back in under 19.
It was like we never played Julen, or we had only heard about Julen.
Right.
So actually faced her, and it was really fun to be to play with Julen. Though that time she was fast, definitely, but even she was in her 19s and teenage.
Right.
It was nice to see such a great bowler, you know, upcoming bowler having so much pace. So it was fun playing with those Rumeli and Julen too. She was fast, definitely. I can say that she was fast.
Okay. So for how many years did you play for Maharashtra under 19 before moving to the other ladder?
Now, actually, I started in 96. So I played for Maharashtra under 19 till around 4 to 5 years.
So you played for 4 years under 19.
Yeah. While playing under 19 team, I was into the senior Maharashtra team.
Oh,
when
okay.
like Hazaribagh happened, I was leading the under 19 team, and with that I was also into the senior team.
And back then there was this tournament which was quite popular, Rani Jhansi tournament, and that sort of was a base for, you know, all the promotions which used to happen. How did you get into the Air India team? Was there any performances in the Rani Jhansi that got you to the Air India, or was it something else?
Actually, we were playing one invitation tournament in Bhadrachalam.
Okay.
And there, there was like AP team. That time there was Andhra Pradesh team. So there were players from Air India like Purnima Rao and I guess Harsha and few else. The Railways and Air India players who used to play for AP, they were playing for the AP team. That time I had did well for Maharashtra, bowling and fielding too. So I was asked that time that are you interested in joining Air India? But I had no, I mean, for me it was too early to say yes for Air India. So I was like, I'll prepare and then get back to Air India.
Okay.
But yeah, definitely I was playing my interzonals in Pune. That time I had performed well for the West Zone. So at that point of time, I was I was called for Air India team. Like 2002, Air India happened. There was interzonals in Pune in 2001 or 2000.
Okay.
That time the Purnima Rao herself had seen me playing for West Zone, and then she had asked me that, are you interested in the Air India team?
I had a word with the Rumeli ma'am for the female cricket podcast. And recently, I also spoke to Devika Palshikar ma'am, and they both, had got incredible stories, and they had so much to talk about Air India and how it shaped them as a cricketer and as a person. I'm sure it had made a lot of impact in your journey as well. Quickly take us through those Air India days, take us through those Air India moments. What exactly it meant for you? How did it develop your cricket overall?
It was Air India days won't happen quickly, to be very honest, but definitely I'll try my best. Because I had the best time in Air India team.
Yeah.
We used to have camps in Mumbai before the tournament. So actually when I joined Air India, we were going to play an invitation tournament in Calcutta. So that was my first air journey which I remembered. Then I had a few incidences which I guess Devika also might have shared with you, that we were playing a match in Boisar, and myself and Devika were batting.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this incident almost stopped the match for 2 to 3 minutes. Very funny incident. I was on the strike, and I think Mumbai bowler Sonali Chandok was bowling. I had stepped out to her and I had hit a brilliant shot bowler's back. And we were like just, we could see that it was almost a four. So we, me and Devika came in a bit and then suddenly we could see the boundary line fielder had picked up the ball inches before the boundary. There was one, what you can say, there was one hole. And in that hole, that ball had gone. And we were royally celebrating. After that, when we realized that it was not a four and the ball is coming back, we just couldn't understand where to go. So she went back to the non-striker's end and I went back to the striker's end. There was no run scored in that. And whole Mumbai team stopped the match and they were laughing for 3 minutes. This I will never forget. And we were so lucky that Punimara had not seen this incident. Yes, of course, Fiona ma'am had seen that incident. But in the team meeting, it was just me and Devika. Focus was on me and Devika. That what were you doing when you even realized that it's not a boundary? You could have at least run one single run. It was the best. I mean, we had a best time in Air India. We used to practice hard, work hard. And we used to enjoy as well as a team. You know, there was no team building exercises required. We as a team were so amazing together. And the best part was, I guess Devika had just started bowling leg spin. Or she just 1-2 years. And I was initially bowling medium pace. But Purnima Rao ma'am, she thought that I could be a very good spinner. And she had converted me into an off spinner. So when we used to get bowling every time when there is a crucial point in match. So at one point in our careers, I can assure you that Devika also must be feeling the same, that we used to get bored while bowling in a comfortable situation. We were so used to bowling in a crunch situation that it was very normal. It had become very normal for us to bowl in a crunch situation, bat in a crunch situation. So these are the experiences which helped us when we actually played the higher level. That, you know, how you can play or how you have to have a mindset during a crunch situation when the match is closed. How you can calm your nerves.
Right.
So it was a very good learning process. And the best part was everyone being from different teams, we could adjust together. We could play excellent cricket, understanding each other. Yeah. They were very much very good seniors. Like Anjudi was there, Anju Jain, Anjumdi was there. Then not many seniors who could, you know, who helped us in the process of being a matured cricketer or a player who can, you know, analyze the game of cricket.
Right.
You can say.
Right.
So it Air India was like Julan was there. That point of time, Julan was at her peak, and. Jujay was at her peak, and we could see I had only heard about Anju Jain or Julan Goswami. Actually being with them, playing with them, like Purnima Rao, these are the legends of the game. I can say I have seen Anju Jain keeping to Julan right behind the stumps when Julan was at peak. So that was, for me, I was like, wow, I have never seen a keeper like Anju Jain. I can tell you that till date. She was excellent. I mean, just excellent. And you can imagine standing to Julan right behind the stumps in nets. It is very difficult.
Right.
I was very fortunate to have, to play with all these legends and to spend time with them. Discussing cricket also, and of course, the fun times as well.
I've heard a lot about Air India and Railways rivalry. Differently banter with the team used to have in the domestic competition. And any memorable match that you have against Railways?
Definitely. Actually, I was not playing the match. It was in Lucknow. It was Lucknow National. I was not playing the match, but still, it was at that time, we used to have a 3-day match, final especially, of senior nationals. So that match, it was like the Railways team had to just chase 113 runs, 113.
Okay.
And Air India had got them all out. Air India had Railways got all out 100 all out.
Okay.
So it was that. I cannot forget that match. Deepali Patkar, one of the very good bowlers in Air India, she had got 6 wickets in that match.
Okay.
And it was just amazing match. The way we had come back into that match, you know, I can. sitting out also, I was in, like into the match completely for 3 days. It was just the best. And that year, actually, Air India had won all the domestic tournaments. Senior nationals, interzonals, beating railways. So it was like, it used to be very good rivalry actually. But on the field and off the field, it was all good.
Right.
It happens actually. Because no, the railways is being the best team and Air India was also the best team.
That's the beauty of this game, right? On field, you're something else. You want definitely. To show that you are the best. Off field, you are like, you know, just another friend.
Definitely. It was like, you know, when two best teams play, of course, one team has to win and one team has to lose. But it was fun. The way we used to fight right till the end of the match. That was also one learning process, not to give up till the last ball is bowled. You know, we learned a lot many things in Air India actually, to be very honest.
Right.
How to, you know, take your partner. I mean, senior, I won't say senior or junior, but if you are batting, then you become the senior partner. Whoever comes in becomes the new partner. So, how to win matches. I learned a lot in Air India actually. How to give confidence to the players when you are a senior player.
Okay.
If you are not a senior player, how to give other players confidence in a match. Or in a team as such.
I wish there was an Air India team now and we could have, you know, had that opportunity to watch
seriously.
Air India and Railways.
Seriously.
But very unfortunate that now we can't watch that rivalry happen in the domestic cricket.
I know. Actually, I miss Air India days a lot actually. One of the best days in my life.
Okay. And one more incident from your Air India days, which I can remember is you meeting or having a chance to watch Sachin Tendulkar play and bat at Kalina.
We used to have practice at MIG, and actually for me personally that was a different kind of experience because that particular day when we met Sachin. We used to go by auto to the MIG ground and me and two of my friends were late. And I was completely into that, our auto has reached late, we are going to be late. We might get something that why are you late and all. And I was just rushing through this ground towards the net. And suddenly one of my friends was like, Sachin. And I was searching the whole ground and I was like, where can we find Sachin? And he just ran in front of us. So I was like, oh. So that day actually it was extremely difficult for every one of us to practice on that ground because he was, I guess, preparing for the 2003 Australia tour and it was like we had our net. So I guess we had five bowlers and a batsman in the net. Yeah. Whoever is bowling was only focusing on the batsman. Rest four were looking at what Sachin is doing. So finally Purnima Rao had to just stop the net. She knew Sachin Tendulkar, of course, so she made him, he just told him that the girls want to meet and all, and it was like amazing. You know, you just, definitely it is so obvious that when he is batting, you just can't take eyes off his batting, even though he's practicing or right. Even if he's playing in the match. So that was a very unforgettable incident and till date I can have goosebumps remembering that incident.
Oh wow, amazing.
So it was really amazing to meet that Sachin Tendulkar.
There's this, you know, saying that Air India team used to carry that aura with them wherever they used to go.
And it was, you know, whenever we used to come onto the ground, even if the other team, they of course they said that we had an aura, but it was for us, it was just the staying together thing automatically. That came automatically when we used to come together, wear same color t-shirts. Travel together, have dinner, lunch together. It used to be like whenever we are done with a match, I'll say dinner kitne baje, kitne baje lunch. It used to come automatically.
Right.
We never had to be told that aaj we are going to have lunch together or a dinner together. It was obvious that we used to come and have dinner together. So as I said that the focus of being together, it automatically came to every one of us. So it was just an amazing experience while playing Air India.
What I've also read is, ma'am, that Air India team was quite professional in their approach and there used to be several departments. So there was one department who used to look after the laundry, there was one department who used to look after the entertainment, there was one department, like you said, used to, you know, take care after the lunch and dinner, what people used to have. which department were you part of?
Actually, it used to be a rotation for everyone, like collecting a laundry. It was used to be like 2 days, two days, there were two people who used to collect laundry. Then when we used to stay in our flats, flat in Kalina Society, and we used to also go and throw the dustbin. For that also we had rotation, carrying the balls, collecting the balls. So it was a rotation for everyone. Just before the tournament, like I was, sometimes, like most of the times I used to be in a cheering department. Then it was actually fun to have all the roles. Then suddenly, when we used to have a practice match, Purnima, like Puridi used to give us like, acha, now 5 overs you are going to do do a captaincy role. This was a big learning process. That what, how you are going to think in a particular situation. Let that be any easy situation or let that be a difficult situation. We came to know what we can do and how it has to be done. So this was a very big learning process for all of the youngsters who were in the team. Because it was like, sometimes Anjali used to tell us that how you have to bowl in such situations, because keeper is the best person who can tell you or judge the actually in the match. So you cannot have a correct person other than Anju Jain.
Right,
so she
right.
used to help us a lot. They used to tell us in the net that how this can be done, or like I, being a spinner, how you can change the pace of the ball, or how can you fly, give the flight, how can you change or vary the flight.
Okay.
So it was a big, big learning experience. Even if we used to not play in the 11, we used to get so much of inputs regarding the match, discussing the match, what has to be done or what you can do. So these 4 years, it was like we enjoyed a lot. We learned and it more than like, you know, I can say that was the best learning time for me personally, actually.
Lovely. Which was the last match that you remember you played for Air India?
I guess, unfortunately, it was the match against MP which we had lost.
Okay.
And after that, it was like BCCI came in.
Okay, so that was the last match, and after that came in, BCCI came in the picture, and it got merged with WCAI.
Yeah.
Okay. After that, you came back to Maharashtra after Air India, or did you play for some other team?
No, I was back to Maharashtra, but initially I was not chosen for Maharashtra team to play the West Zone. But then they had selected me to play the senior national after the West Zone. But after that, I was playing for Maharashtra till 2013. 13 and 14, I played for Karnataka.
You made your debut at 29, right, ma'am?
Yeah, 30.
Okay. And any particular reason why you were like, you had to delay it for so long? Was there a lot of competitions back then? Or was there injuries that you...
Actually, I will say that... I was a player. I mean, after Air India, I had heard that I was going to be in India camp two times, but I don't know why it didn't happen. After that, 2009 and 10 were the best years where I did well, I feel. So after 2009, when I played in 2010, I was selected for the team in 2010.
Yeah.
But I in Maharashtra team, what is to happen? We had really good team that point of time. So if your team is getting the opponent out at let's say 60 or 70, and you, I being the middle order batsman, I will not get a chance to score any runs.
Right.
So it this point, all these things used to, you know, come. I cannot, you know, you just cannot tell someone that I will go opening because we have got them out for 70 runs.
Right.
Even for that, I used to have bowling in, like, you know, after let's say 10-15 overs. But till then, if the medium pacer has got half of the side in for the other opponent team, you cannot have a 5-wicket haul at all. So my bowling analysis used to be good. It used to be like 10 overs, let's say 3 maidens, 20-30 runs and 1 or 2 wickets.
Okay.
But I guess you needed much more for that, for the higher level. So I just kept working hard. These things did happen, because of which actually there was no, I can say, a big score to my name till then. But after in 2010, when T20 was introduced, not in 2010, but when the T20 was introduced, it was like maybe that suited my game more. So I had pretty good performances in the T20 matches we played. I could bowl the new ball, that was a plus point for me.
Yeah.
And definitely I can happily say that I was a person who could hit long sixes at my own will, which I did actually.
Right.
So I used to play that attacking kind of a game, yeah, which helped me in T20. So at right. that point of time, that was the game which suited me, my type of game more. So that was maybe the I was waiting for T20 to get introduced.
I think that is the reason why you have got more T20s to your name than ODIs.
Yeah.
You have 13 yeah. T20s and 4 ODIs to your name.
Yeah, 4 ODIs. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, tell me about this debut game when you got to know that now I'll be wearing India blue jersey and playing for my country for the very first time.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, it fortunately, I don't know whether it is fortunate or unfortunate, I don't know, but I came to know the previous night that I was going to be playing in the 11th. So it was very difficult for me to sleep that night. And then, unfortunately, there was no such, what you can say, that handing a cap to the debutant. There was no such practices at that point of time. So right. I missed out on that. Yeah, but definitely, when I was, I guess when I made my debut on the 24th of Feb, India were fielding first, and for first 15 overs, I was not understanding a single thing happening on the ground. I mean, I remember, I guess on Julan's bowling, there was one catch I stopped out. I was at midwicket, fielding at midwicket, and it was in the air for a long time. I just waited for the ball to drop, and then I collected it one bounce. And Julan had no idea what I was doing. Anjumdi was like, Julan, just ignore it. Let us settle down. And I was like, I couldn't even remember that was a catch, or I really took it on one bounce. I mean, it was just for 15 hours, I had all the emotions in my life. I was excited, I was nervous, I was happy, I was a bit conscious that, but it was definitely the best moment in my life, you know. Then you just have to say that, you know, you stand in a circle and you just shout India. That is like, you know, just get goosebumps and the proud feeling which you get representing your country. I mean, there cannot be any bigger moment than this, you know.
Right. When you stand there, you know, the national anthem is playing with your team members and
those moments, you know, you cannot explain to anyone actually. Actually, that series, I had a definitely more special moment because after that, when I made my debut on 24th Feb, the same day Sachin Tendulkar scored the first 100, so it became more special for me.
Wow.
Actually.
Wow.
Yeah, so evening it was the treat to watch him bat against South Africa.
Right. So back at your home, there would have been double celebrations happening.
Yeah, definitely. They were all watching me. Unfortunately, the England series was telecast on TV, so they could watch me play. And then after the fourth ODI, when we were supposed to play the last ODI in Mumbai, my family had come to watch that the BKC stadium.
It can't get any better than that, you know, your parents and your family members exactly. coming out to watch you. Amazing.
Yeah,
so this debut match happened and you and India won that match, and then for 4 years, for continuous 4 years, you were part of the India side.
So like I was in and out because unfortunately in 2011 I had a knee injury, ligament injury.
Oh, okay.
I mean, that was the worst time I could have got an injury because when you have your captain, I mean, Julan was leading that time. Hmm. And I guess we were going to have an England series in June. Hmm. And in Jan, I was playing a domestic T20 tournament in Jaipur. Hmm. So at that point of time, I was fielding at covers and my knee got stuck. My spike got stuck and my knee was almost shifted to other side and I had to get it back. Oh. So that injury was so at a very wrong time. Hmm. Actually, to be very honest, Julan has had almost told me that just get ready or be ready to bowl in England or think how you're going to bowl in England. So when your captain is so confident about you and gives you a lot of this kind of confidence.
Yeah.
So I was all set that I, you know, how I'm going to prepare. But this injury was at such a wrong time that I had to wait for almost 2 to 3 years to be back into the side. Okay. Even though I had done very good in T20s, like I had fastest 50 in 2012 versus Mumbai, that too at ABKC. I had, I guess, I don't know, but I was told at that time that it was a record in domestic cricket because I had scored a 19 or 20 ball 51.
Wow.
So, in spite of that, unfortunately, I had missed out for the camp as well, for the T20 World Cup. But these injuries was, you know, this injury specifically, the knee injury, was at a very
crucial
bad time to get an injury. Crucial time, because you know when you are doing good for your team, when you're you can say captain has so much confidence in you, and you get this injury, it becomes very difficult for a player to get back into the side, because that time the competition of cricket has gone so higher that you just have to be at the best just to get into the side.
And you made a comeback after this injury, and the last match I remember which you played, it was against Pakistan, and again it was a memorable game because you were player of the match in that in this game. You got 3 wickets. Tell me about this special match of yours.
Yeah, definitely. This has a long story because the day before Pakistan match, I was in hospital in Bangladesh because of food poisoning.
Oh, is it?
And no one thought that I could play that. Yeah, no one thought that I could play the Pakistan match. But I was like, somewhere back of the mind, I knew that this was going to be my last match. So I just didn't want to miss match against Pakistan. You know, all of my life I dreamt about playing against Pakistan. So I just didn't want to miss it. But actually, that World Cup was very good for me. I had bowled superbly. I used to open for the Indian team.
Yeah.
I missed out on the West Indies match because of this food poisoning.
Okay.
It was actually very bad. I was on saline for the whole day. And then I came back and played the Pakistan match.
Wow.
And then I got the Women of the Match as well. So it became more special for me.
Yeah, exactly. To come from that condition, from that situation where you're hospitalized, and then the very next day you're playing a match, that to a very crucial match against Pakistan, and you got your player of the match. Did you knew beforehand that this is going to be your last match? Were you like mentally prepared that you're not going to play for India after this?
Somewhere I knew that I might. So it was like I don't want to miss on this fastest because I was not well the previous day. Definitely because I think Mithali and Purnima Rao had asked me, are you sure you want to play that match? Because they knew my condition the day before was not very good.
Yeah.
I mean, almost in 2 days, since 3 days I was having a bad stomach. So they were like, are you sure you're going to play? I was like, I am very sure that I'm not going to miss this match. Because somewhere, you know, sometimes you realize that it won't be possible or it won't be that easy to get back into the team after this World Cup. So I was like, yeah, definitely I'm going to play that match.
What happened after 2014, ma'am, after you played your last match for India? What happened after that? Did you take up coaching immediately or did you sort of took a break for yourself and came back to cricket again?
I did take a break definitely, but coaching had started before 2014 itself. I used to practice at PYC. But that point of time I used to take practice of the girls as well and then and practice my cricket as well. So it was before 2014 that I was a part of PYC coaching
panel.
You know, the coaching the PYC girls team. Yeah. So after 2014, I definitely took a break. Then 2016, my daughter was born.
Okay.
After that, in 2017, Heman Kirikar sir, who was a part of PYC coaching staff, he had started his own academy. So he had asked me almost 6 months back as well that are you willing to join the academy as a women's coach? You will be handling all the women's you know team and everything regarding to coaching. So I was pretty happy that he was the one who started his own academy and he is willing to give me an opportunity. So I joined HK Bounce Cricket Academy in 2017.
You've also got your BCCI level 1 done, right, ma'am?
No, I am waiting. Just now only I was going to do the BCCI level 2, which was going to be held for the players, especially directly the level 2. But because of the corona, it got cancelled.
Okay.
I'm still waiting for the level 1 course as well.
Okay. But the players can directly apply for level 2.
No, actually, this level 2 course was going to happen for the ex-players. And they were going to organize level 2 for especially for the ex-players this time. It was, I guess, the first time they were going to organize. Now, let's see how things goes.
Okay, and then Corona happened and things basically stopped for everyone. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I know.
You spoke about your daughter. Is she also into cricket? Do you want to make her play for India?
It's like other cricketer. I really want her to play, but I won't definitely won't force her because now this generation of kids, they are so thoughtful, or they are, you know, like now who want to play cricket. Whenever she grow up, I don't know what's going to happen, but definitely I'll force her to play one sport at least, just for, because you know, you just can't you know, keep going into school and college and studies. You have to play one sport because it definitely helps you groom yourself as a person. Let her play as fun, or let her play for you know, just to be fit, or let that be a competitive game. But if you are a sports person, your stance a bit different and your thinking processes change, I feel, you know, because you know what is happening, how, you know, you mix up with different kinds of people. There are people who can, you know, sometimes you won't agree to what you are saying. So you learn to accept that as well. So I just definitely want her to play one sport, let that be for a competitive level or for fun. But she will, I'll make sure that she plays anything, some sport at least. Let there be anything.
So ma'am, you started your journey in 95. You played till 2014, the professional cricket. Now that, you know, women's cricket has evolved a lot in last 2 to 3 years, we have seen, you know, 2017 we were the runners up in the World Cup. 2020 also we were the runners up in the World Cup. So what is sort of keeping us behind and not letting us win the crucial tournaments and win the final of these crucial matches?
I think definitely it's time to have a women's IPL, because as I said that these girls, when they played the last T20 final in Australia, these girls are extremely potential. They have lot of skills as compared to the, you know, gun teams, you can say, Australia, New Zealand, England. They do have similar set of skills, but I feel they should get exposure to play in front of large crowds, because that's what happened in T20 finals. They are not used to play in front of so many crowds. So that mental aspect has to be, you can say, they do have, I have heard that they do have few mental toughness sessions and all. But I think if you start these sessions from a grassroots level, you know, like a domestic level, like you can have the mental toughness sessions for senior team or maybe an under-19. So if you can start for mental toughness sessions for under-19 team as well as a senior domestic team, and definitely the start of IPL is, the time has come to start the women's IPL, because these girls, when you'll play in front of large crowds, automatically they will have in mind that this is what happens when you play in front of so many people.
Right.
Because they, now Australians have England people have Kia Super League. Even if Smriti or let's say Deepti, Jemima, Harman, these are the girls who have been playing over there. But definitely, if we start in our own country, there are many girls who are equally good. They will also get the exposure of playing in front of large crowds, and which will definitely help these people. There is no doubt about the skill levels or the fitness levels. I would definitely see, I would know, to have to, for the players to have a better, much more improvement in their fielding, I think. They are good, but I feel they can be they can improve a bit more as well.
Okay.
I won't say that they are not good. Mm-hmm. But as you must have seen the T20 World Cup, they were very good actually, but in patches. The consistency of being good in fielding has to be there, I feel.
Okay. A couple of years back, ma'am, the Karnataka state had a women's IPL, a mini IPL sort of a thing, where they put up 8 teams together and they play the tournament. Do you think such similar tournaments can now be replicated by other state teams till we have a full-fledged women's IPL? Because this could act as a feeder for women's IPL tomorrow.
actually there are similar tournaments. You cannot say women's IPL as such, there are similar tournaments in Pune or in Maharashtra which are happening. You know, like there are few what you can say institutions. I cannot say institutions, but there are few people who do organize such tournaments.
Okay.
But it is like most of the Pune girls or Maharashtra girls do come and play these tournaments. So it similar tournaments are happening.
Hmm.
But you cannot call the girls outside Maharashtra because they don't have that much facility. So if like now already BCCI has started the mini IPL for the girls. So if they can extend it to the full-fledged women's IPL, that could be it could help the girls who are already playing onto the domestic level. You know, when they get exposure to playing with the international players, you know, players from Australia, England, West Indies, New Zealand, they definitely learn a lot of things, how to approach game, how to play in a particular situation, how to bowl a different kind of varieties in bowling, or similar kind of things, you know, when you get exposure, like casually or in generally also you tell the players that the more you play practice matches, you will get you'll get exposure and you'll get more experience in how to play the matches in when you actually go and play it in the tournament.
Right.
So it is similar to this when you you know talk to senior players or the more I won't say senior, but I'll definitely say more experienced players, outside players, their approach, their fitness levels or what they do a bit extra, which helps them to get over the other players.
Right.
So if you can just know that, it is not necessary that you follow the same thing that what they do, but at least you will know what others are doing. You can anytime decide whatever is good for you, but at least when you are aware that how the world is approaching or how the international cricketers are approaching the game, definitely it will help you as well. Or it might help them as well watching you.
Right.
You never know, you know.
Right.
Because it is like the outside players definitely face difficulty in facing our spinners. So they might even learn from our batsmen as well how to approach the spinners or how to play play the spinners. So similarly, it might be both ways actually.
That's a great suggestion, ma'am. That's a very valuable point that you have put forward. My next question to you is, as a coach, have you got any milestones or have you got any goal as such that, you know, this is what I want to achieve as a coach?
When I started actually in 2017 when I joined HK Bounce, I had the small goal of at least making 2 to 3 players getting into the Maharashtra team, which I definitely achieved. You must have heard now Sai Purandare, about her.
Yes.
She represents Meghalaya now. Yeah.
Lovely.
Then there was one girl who, 2-3 girls I definitely made. Now the next goal definitely is doing a level 1 whenever time permits or whenever Corona permits, more precise. So my daughter being a bit small, I am not aiming for a bigger goal definitely right now, but definitely I would like to do some coaching at least for a state team, for my Maharashtra state team as well to start off with. But definitely I would like to play a role what Rahul Dravid is playing, you know, making good players. That is what I aim for, you know, at the grassroots level, you know, under 19 or under 23. Because that's the time you can groom the players, you can make them understand what exactly things are, what exactly you have to face. They do understand at that point of time that it is very important how you analyze the game. That is the best time I think you can tell the player, you know, 19 or under 19 or an under 23 team. I would definitely love to coach under 19 or under 23 team.
Lovely.
For sure.
Lovely. Let's consider a hypothetical situation, ma'am. I know you're super into about coaching. Because the situation is that let's say that you have been given a position which currently, you know, Rahul Dravid sir holds, and you have to do something very similar to women's cricket. You have to do something very similar for women's cricket. What are the three instant things, three next steps that you would take in order to elevate the women's cricket the domestic level or international level?
Oh, definitely, as I said before that, I would definitely have more of a mental toughness session for them, for sure.
Okay.
The second thing I will be that they will have a, you know, everyone is now talking about you have to be fit, you have to be fit. But I feel that definitely it is the most important thing, to be at the highest level of fitness. But I would see that there is more cricket specific fitness given to them. I am not saying it is not given to them, but you know, like they should be able to do more of a cricketing drills, which may, you know, have more enjoying time for them doing the fitness activity as well. And the third thing that I will definitely focus more on fielding instead of batting and bowling, because that's the thing they keep on doing the whole year, whole year at home. Yeah. So I feel that fielding is one thing we need to definitely focus more, because as I said that when you do nets the whole year, there is no one, I know few, very few people who just go onto the ground and do fielding drills and come back. No one does that. I think we should definitely, because fielding is one such thing where no one can stop you. You know, you yourself have to compete with yourself. The more you raise your standard, it will raise the standard of the team. The more you field well, the more you focus on giving your best. And in fielding, it is who you put in your effort. In batting, if you are given a wrong decision, you are out. You cannot just do anything in that. In bowling, if someone drops a catch on your bowling, you cannot do. In fielding, it is only that particular person who has to do the thing. So it is in your hand. It is actually the person, for specific person, who can do 200% best for the team. So I feel that when so much is in your control, why not use it? Because you always, you know, it is heard that you cannot control the controllables. But this, which is the fielding part, is always in your hands. It is up to you how much to stretch your limit. So definitely, why not?
Wow, wow. I've heard a lot about fielding, but the way you explained it, ma'am, it was amazing. This was something very new, and I honestly got to learn about the way a coach thinks today, and your approach of, you know, conveying things. It was beautiful. The example was amazing.
Yeah, even back home, like for my club girls, I used to tell them the same thing. You know, I want to see you girls putting effort. It's okay if you drop a catch. It's okay if you do a misfield. But I cannot take that you're not even putting the effort. Putting your 200%, 150% effort is very important for me. Losing and winning a match, it doesn't matter to me much. I mean, someone has to lose, someone will win, someone will lose. But right, putting your efforts, you know, when the efforts are seen, definitely, you know, you have a chance to groom, or you have a chance to improve after that. But if you are not going to put in efforts and just, you know, because a coach can just, now I can analyze why my coach used to get maybe a bit angry on me, that why can't you play this way? Why can't you play that way? It is very difficult job of a coach to just sit and tell, because a player is one who has to do the things inside the ground. So better late. I really now get to see many, definitely many funny incidences and very amazing experiences while I was coaching. Yeah.
I'm sure, you know, your learnings will definitely help a lot of young girls to sort of go up the ladder and play for their state and domestic and national teams very soon. My final question to you, ma'am, before we...
Thank you so much. I hope so.
Before we wrap up the session, what is that one quick advice which you have to give to a young cricketer who is just starting to play cricket?
I will just tell the person or the player that just keep enjoying your game and keep working hard and smart, because nowadays you need to work smart as well as hard work. You have to do the both. You have to do both the things. And definitely most important, enjoy what you're doing, because unless you are not enjoying what you're doing, how much effort you're putting will go, I won't say will go waste, but definitely if you enjoy the game, or if you enjoy whatever you're doing, it will help the person or a player grow more. And another thing I would like to tell, that focus on the process. Don't think what I am going to do or what I'll be become. Just focus on what you have to do to reach a certain level. Focus on the present process which you have to follow.
That's a very beautiful piece of advice, and it has got a lot of depth. Whoever can, you know, the youngsters, whoever is listening, if he or she can inculcate the same thing in his or her cricket, I'm sure he'll become a beautiful cricketer. Thank you for sharing such valuable insights from your journey, ma'am. And thank you for talking to us.
Thank you so much, Vishal.